Good morning, and welcome to Buxton United Methodist Church. We're so glad that you're here to worship with us this morning, and that you remembered to set your clocks ahead. We may have some late stragglers today who forgot to do that. You never know. I want to go through the morning announcements, so let's take a quick peek. We have, are there any celebrations, birthdays, or anniversaries? Yes, Jean.
Keith turns 16 tomorrow.
Keith, 16 tomorrow. Wow. That does not seem possible.
Ooh.
Any others? All right, then. Let's go on to the next. Following worship, there will be fellowship time downstairs, so I hope you enjoy that.
Holy grace.
All right. Keep up with your Bible reading challenge. My goodness, we're already into March. Lenten service projects begin. We've been working on those. I know that you're making calls. Some of you are making meals even. Notes, those things are all, they mean so much to our folks who are really, for the most part, homebound or away. So please continue with that. They are so appreciated, and I appreciate your help as well. Wednesday morning, 9 a.m. is supposed to be Bible study. I have a feeling we're going to have to either postpone or cancel. So be watching your email, and we'll use the phone tree. Choir practice, TBA. Do we have one scheduled for an evening practice coming up, or no?
Well, we're thinking of at least March 29th.
Okay. Not until March 29th. Great. Prepare our hearts for worship now. Let's do so and have the ringing of the bell, the prelude, and lighting of candles.
Temptations we are to resist. Here is a verse from Genesis that will give us encouragement this week to resist temptation. If you do what is right, will you not be accepted? But if you do not do what is right, sin is crouching at your door. It desires to have you, but you must rule over it. From Genesis chapter 4, verse 7.
Called the first family. After this Eve gave birth to Cain's brother Abel. Abel took care of sheep. Cain became a farmer. Later, Cain brought a gift to God. He brought some food from the ground. Abel brought the best parts of his best sheep. The Lord accepted Abel and his gift, but God did not accept Cain and his gift. Cain became very angry and looked unhappy. The Lord said to Cain, "Why are you angry? Why do you look so unhappy? If you do good, I will accept you. But if you do not do good, sin is ready to attack you. Sin wants you, but you must rule over it." Cain said to his brother Abel, "Let's go out into the field." So Cain and Abel went into the field. Then Cain attacked his brother Abel, and he killed him. Later, the Lord said to Cain, "Where is your brother Abel?" Cain answered, "I don't know. Is it my job to take care of my brother?" Then the Lord said, "What have you done? Your brother's blood is on the ground. That blood is like a voice that tells me what happened. And now you will be cursed in your work with the ground, with the ground. It is the same ground where your brother's blood fell. Your hands killed him. You will work the ground, but it will not grow good crops at all for you anymore. You will wander around on the earth." Then Cain said to the Lord, "This punishment is more than I can ever bear. Look, you have forced me to stop working the ground, and now I must hide from you. I will wander around on the earth, and anyone who meets me will want to kill me." Then the Lord said to Cain, "Not if anyone kills you. I will punish that person 7 times more." Then the Lord put a mark on Cain. It was a warning to anyone who met him not to kill him. Now, the epistle is James 4, 1 through 10. Because this week is resist, as we know, and I was thinking before I started reading this one from James, which I love, there is one in James that tells about the tongue being the smallest appendage in our body, but it can do the biggest harm. And I think of the times when we've fallen or when we've cut ourselves or whatever. We heal, but we have a scar, don't we? That reminds us what has happened. And that is what will happen if we hurt other people's feelings. If we say things to them that we shouldn't say, it will heal, but it'll always be there. So be careful what you say. If you meet someone you haven't seen for a long time, tell them how much you miss them, or tell them how much you care about them. But try not to say anything hurtful, because it will heal, but the scar will always be there. Thank you. And this week's is James 4, 1 through 10. Give yourselves to God. Do you know what your fights and arguments come from? They come from the selfish desires that make war inside you. You want things, but you do not have them. So you are ready to kill and are jealous of other people, but you still cannot get what you want. So you argue and you fight. You do not get what you want because you do not ask God. Or when you ask, you do not receive because the reason you ask is wrong. You want things only that you can use them for your own pleasures. So you, people, are not loyal to God. You should know that loving the world is the same as hating God. So if a person wants to be a friend of the world, he makes himself God's enemy. Do you think the scripture means nothing? It says, "The spirit that God made to live in us wants us for himself alone. But God gives us even more grace, as the scripture says, 'God is against the proud, but he gives grace to the humble.'" Proverbs 3:34. So give yourselves to God. Stand against the devil, and the devil will run away from you. Come near to God, and God will come near to you. You are sinners, so clean your sin out of your lives. You are trying to follow God and the world at the same time. Make your thinking pure. Be sad, cry, and weep. Change your laughter into crying. Change your joy into sadness. Don't be proud before the Lord, and he will make you great. Thank you. And now we're going to be blessed with a song from our choir, and it's called "He Grew the Tree."
Thank you.
Abel, please stand for the reading of the gospel. This is called The Temptation of Jesus, Matthew 4, 1 through 11. Then the Spirit led Jesus into the desert to be tempted by the devil. Jesus ate nothing, not anything, but 40 days and nights. After this, he was very hungry. The devil came to Jesus to tempt him. The devil said, "If you truly are the Son of God, take these rocks and make them into bread." Jesus answered, "It is written in the scriptures, a person does not live by bread alone, but a person lives by everything the Lord says." Then the devil led Jesus into the holy city of Jerusalem. He put Jesus on a very high place of the temple. The devil said, "If you are the Son of God, jump off. It is written in the scriptures, he has put his angels in charge of you. They will catch you with their hands, and you will not hit your foot on a rock." That's Psalm 91, 11 and 12. Jesus answered him, "It also says in the scriptures, do not test the Lord your God." Then the devil led Jesus to the top of a very high mountain. He showed Jesus all the kingdoms of the world and all the great things that are in those kingdoms. The devil said, "If you will bow down to me and just worship me, I will give you all these things." Jesus said to the devil, "Go away from me, Satan. It is written in the scriptures, you must worship the Lord your God and serve only him." So the devil left Jesus, and then some angels came to Jesus and helped him. And all who believe, please say, Amen. Amen. And now we are going to sing, "Lord, who throughout these 40 days of the United Methodist Hymnal 269 are appear on the hill."
Resisting.
ice cream for another in the back. Oh boy. Yeah. Donuts for Lynn. Okay. We've got a little theme here among our women, don't we? And Maria Lynn. How about a favorite activity? Do you have a favorite activity that you can't resist? Sean, did you say something? I thought you did. Okay.
Watching football.
Watching football. Okay. All right. Come on, kid. Out with it. Come on. Okay. Video games, computers, technology, all that stuff, right? Very good. Thank you, Kevin. I put you on the spot. Sorry. It's tough being a PK. The word itself, resist, it implies that there is something that is a temptation for us. In other words, there would be no need to resist something if you weren't being tempted by it, right? Right. Temptation, then, and the lack of our ability to resist it is the very first lesson that we get in the Bible. Adam and Eve were created. God says no. They do it anyway. Humankind is barely out of the starting gate, and we're already falling to temptation. We saw that again in our Old Testament lesson today. Cain's jealousy and his anger, it was in control of him, not him in control of it. He got caught up in his rage and he could not resist the temptation of eliminating his competition, even if it was his own brother. And God tells Cain, if you do not do what is right, sin is crouching at your door. It desires to have you. You must rule over it. Powerful, powerful words. And these words are from our Creator. Sin desires to have us, but we must rule over sin. That means that we resist. Now, in our epistle lesson, James wrote, resist the devil and he will flee from you. We know it up here in our minds, right? But it's a whole lot harder to actually resist than it is to simply know that we should, right? Let me share a story with you about that. You all know that on our vacation, we went to Florida and swam with the manatees. I promised you I would try to find some way to incorporate that into a message. I just didn't expect it to happen so quickly. But as I like to say, this will preach. So I want to show you some pictures as I tell you this story. The first thing that we had to do was to get our wetsuits on. Then we got into our little boat that took us out in search of manatees. So let's take a look at that first one. There we go. I hope you can see it. It's always hard because so much light comes in. But those are my three men in the family already in their wetsuits. They were such fun to wear, and they really make you feel tough. I don't know if you've ever worn one before, but they really do feel like there's three hot women right here. Let's take a look at the next one. And then we went out to the cove where there was lots of grass and we started to look for the manatees. You see, they like to eat the wet grass, so this is really good feeding grounds for them. They have to come up to breathe air, so you look for little noses and little ripples of circles that are made when they come up. That's how you search for them. Let's take a look at the third one. Oh my goodness, there's some water looking underneath. And you get into the water after a quick snorkeling lesson. Now I admit I had a rough start. a very rough start. Because water kept getting into my snorkel, and I couldn't get it out. Now, they said to me, just blow it out. Well, that's fine and good if you're a real windbag. And I thought I was. But apparently, I'm not enough of one, because the water, it just kept coming right back down the snorkel, and then it would go into my throat and choke me, made me gag. Then once I figured out that you can just take the darn thing out of your mouth and dump it out, then I was okay. But they kept saying, blow it, blow it, blow it. It didn't work for me. Oh my goodness. Let's look at the next slide, because we have to get back to the manatees. Here are the two boys. They give you a pool noodle that you're to kind of put under your arms, okay, and they're to help to keep you from thrashing around. And it's really simple, actually. You float, you put your mask in the water so you can see, and if you need to move, they say don't thrash about, just do doggy paddle. That's it. So, hey, easy enough, right? That's it. Float and wait. And they are curious creatures, manatees are, so they come right up to you. And they'll come close because they don't have good vision. Oh, does that please my heart? They have exceptional hearing, though. And they can hear, we learned, a human heartbeat in the water from 8 feet away. Isn't that amazing that they could discern every single person's heartbeat and how it was different? So, breathe through your snorkel, look through your mask, float and wait. It was that simple. And before you know it, here's what happens. All of a sudden, you see a face that only a mother could love. Along comes a face trying to get a good look at you because they don't have good vision. Let's take a look at the next one. Can you see that one with your little nose right there?
Oh,
they will come right up to you and blow in your face. Sometimes they'll bump into your mask. Let's take a look at the next one. Look at that. They will even swim right next to you or right underneath you. And when near you, they will even bump your body in the water. That's what was probably happening here in this next one. Big Mama came and parked right under me and kept bumping my legs with her head, which of course made me laugh, and that of course made me get water in my snorkel. But I'm getting ahead of myself. Let's go back to our quick lesson that we got from our guy. He explained how to use the snorkel, told us to dog paddle out, and then just wait and float. Fine. No problem. But guess what he said next? Any ideas? Oh, say it.
Don't touch them.
Yeah. He told us not to touch them. I'm telling you the truth here. He said, don't touch them, but let them touch you first. You don't touch them first. I think you know where this is headed, right? Friends, let me tell you something. I knew then and there this is going to be hard. Hard for me. Especially that darn baby that was so cute that came right up like that. And I'm a pastor. I should be able to hold back, right? And resist. I can resist, right? Confess before you all today that I fell to temptation. Martin Luther once said, sin boldly, and I did. I wasn't in the presence of that baby for 30 seconds. That cute little face, it came up to look at me, and then it swam right underneath me. It was inches away. Inches. Just under my hand. I'm floating, right? Arms out. It's under my hand. Inches like this. So sure enough, I thought to myself, these things can't see anyway. Maybe they'll think it's bumping me. See how we justify our sin? And I put my hand down a couple inches in the water as it swam underneath me, and I felt its entire back as it swam on by. Now I admit, had it been the mother, I don't know that I would have done that. There are size. She certainly was. And I wouldn't want to make her mad. But the baby. And it didn't seem to mind at all. I don't think it did because it came back several times. And then a few big ones came over too. But the point, of course, is that I fell to temptation. Right? I was told, no. I did it anyway. And who am I to think that I know what's best for this creature? Sin was lurking at my door, but I did not master it that day. I did not resist. Resisting is hard. It was too hard for me on that day, but I had great comfort, and you can too. Because, precious flock, our Jesus understands us. He was tempted for 40 days in the wilderness. He was able to resist, of course. We can't, but he did. As the song says, they are weak, but he is strong. But because our Lord experienced temptation, he understands what we go through on a regular basis and how difficult it is to resist. Now, I have a little multi-sensory activity for us to do today. You were all given a couple of pieces of paper, right? And you were also given a pencil and a brown crayon. So now's the time we're going to learn what we have to do with those. On the first one, I just want you to write your name. And the Anderson boys let me take theirs so that I can show you. Just write your name in pencil. This is important. In pencil. You might need to use a hymnal or something to put underneath, okay? That's what we're gonna do on the first one. Just, you know, pretend you're signing a paycheck or something. You can print, you script, whatever. I just need to have your name on that paper, any size that you want. Now on the other paper, I want you to take your brown crayon and I want you to draw a cross. Not a thin little one, but a big block old ruddy cross. Really color it with that crayon, just like the manatees, I'm blind as a bat. Nice, big, and bright so that if you hold it up like I am, we can all see it, okay? Here's my example. I'm sure you can see it. This is what I want, something that big. Nothing would be, all right? This is the cross of our Lord we're drawing. We'll have a minute or two to do that, and then I want you to raise your hand when you're finished. And in the meantime, our Linda is gonna play some music for us while a few volunteers are gonna come around and help you do something with your pictures, okay? So everybody knows what to do? I think you do, it looks like you're doing it. Ready, set, go.
Thank you. color, any color.
That even though we fail, you have already won the victory for us already on the cross of Calvary. We come before you today giving thanks and praying yet again for you to forgive us for our sins and to help us be strong as we leave today and go forth into the world. We also come before you, Lord, with any joys or concerns or any things that we need to lift before you in prayer. We remember, Lord, that Wendy is coming home today, and we give you thanks. We also pray for our Patty to continue to heal and for our Ron to continue to heal. And now we lift up the names of the people, places, and situations that are on our hearts. Lord God, you know every heart, and you know every mind. And so we know that you know the needs of the names of these people, whether they were spoken or unspoken. And we know that you answer prayer. We give you thanks and pray the prayer you taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We want to thank you all for the many ways that you have given to our church, and of your time, your talent, and your treasure. And I will remind you, there is a plate in the back if you need to put your offering in. Our final hymn this morning is My Hope Is Built. Number 368 in the hymnal or on the screen.
Thank you.
benediction from Billy Graham. I like it a lot. May your troubles be less, your blessings more, and may nothing but joy, peace, and happiness come to your door. Life without God is like an unsharpened pencil. It has no point.